arms.
So we're floating around Toronto Sportsman Show, and I come across none other than Tracey Wilson. How are you?
I'm great. Nice to see you, Corey.
Likewise. So you know what I found really interesting is we were here just setting up for the interview, and then all of a sudden somebody just out of the blue started hollering over here saying thank you.
We hear that a lot, and yeah, I got to say, you know, sometimes I never question whether or not we're doing the right thing, but, you know, because we're not just speaking for ourselves, we're speaking for tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of gun owners. It's important to me that people support what we're saying and what we're doing, and it's really reassuring. All up and down the halls the last few days, it's great. I mean, it's a tough battle, and there's a lot of negative. So a little positive light really helps.
You've been noted as the pit bull of the organization, but with the CCFR, Tracey Wilson, what do you do for anybody out there that doesn't know the pit bull in the front lines?
Well, I'm the Vice President of Public Relations. That's my official title. But what I am is I'm Canada's only in-house registered gun lobbyist. So, you know, when the government officials see they have a meeting with the gun lobby, it's basically me that they're meeting with, which is cute when I walk in and I'm a mom and a grandma, and it's not really what they expect, but you should never let that fool you, because I am absolutely a pit bull. I'm relentless, I never get tired, and, you know, all that negativity actually just fuels me to keep working for gun owners, so.
And we've got a big fight ahead of us, and I know you've got a lot of stuff you got going on. Can you tell the viewers a little bit about what's in the foresight right now that you're focusing on?
So right now we've got Bill C-71 entering the last stages in the Senate. I'm going to be heading back to Ottawa on Sunday from Toronto. Monday I'll be in the Senate all day listening to the witnesses. So the Senator Plett's been doing a really great job. He's the official whip for the opposition in the Senate. He's a conservative senator. He's been doing a great job of literally just having armies of witnesses called to come and testify before the Senate committee, which is great. On the very first day of witness testimony, there were more witnesses in one day at the Senate than there was for the entire discussion of the bill in the House. Or the other place, which is what they refer to it as. So it's interesting to see how far the Senate is going. They're in a unique position right now because they're trying to reinvent themselves, not just be known as the rubber stampers, you know, that just stamp everything and let it through. They're really studying the bill, looking at all, you know, all areas of it, all aspects of it. It is very difficult to stop a majority government bill, and the Senate is not usually the place, it doesn't happen very often, that they completely reject a bill. However, we have a great opportunity to have it sent back to the House with amendments. So that's the focus. So that's Monday. And then, of course, you know, from there, it's just craziness. I'm always working with MPs. I've got a call out to everyone from all parties that if they're looking to do a town hall on the firearms file, you know, which right now includes C-71, the proposed handgun and assault weapons ban by Minister Blair, you know, all those issues that are important to gun owners. If any member of parliament from any party wants to have a town hall and really have a public consultation, not an invite-only public consultation. I'm talking about where average, everyday Canadians get to come and have their voice heard and talk about their concerns. And to me, that is a huge part of democracy. So I've been running around all over the country doing these with different members of parliament. We did just the recent one in Ajax. We had Glenn Motts, Bob Zimmer was there as well. You know, trying to get to these communities that don't get to have their voice heard. We found it especially important to have one right in Ajax, right in Mark Holland's backyard.
And what came out of that town hall? What were some of the interesting maybe perspectives or angles that came out of that town hall?
I think, honestly, through this entire thing, what I'm hearing from Canadians, gun owners and non-gun owners alike, is they're asking, how does C-71 or a handgun ban on licensed legal sports shooters, how is that going to stop crime? You know, would any of this prevented the Danforth shooting? Would any of this prevent the crime and the violence that we're seeing in the streets of Toronto and Surrey and places all across the country? And the problem is the answer is no. So a lot of people are asking me, well, what is the government, you know, they've got these gun control measures they're looking at implementing, but what are they doing about crime? And that's the real problem, is they're doing absolutely nothing. You know, they've been making it rain a little bit lately with our taxpayer money, going around and giving to each province, which was promised 3.5 years ago. But they haven't followed through with the election looming, and now all of a sudden they're making it rain and promising more if they're reelected, right? So It's not something we can just throw money at either.
One thing I really want to point out is the fact that we, as legal gun owners, we want the violence to stop.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of this time, we're arguing over the same topic. It's just we are not agreeing on what the end goal is or how to get there, right, or what the solution is.
So exactly.
If that's the case, that we both want the same things, and it's very clear that the other approach is not working.
Right.
How do we bridge that gap?
Well, I've been working hard on that, too. I know I've been posting about it earlier this year. I think just before Christmas, I traveled here to Toronto from Ottawa, and I met with victims groups, you know, moms who had lost children to gun violence, gang violence. There were some groups there that were representatives of former gang or extremists, you know, that are sort of converted, and now they're trying to keep youth from joining that type of lifestyle. So I met with them. We it was so funny because it's like the conversation the government doesn't want you to have, right? We're on opposing sides of the table. At the end, we really want the same thing. And I came away from that meeting. We felt 3 hours wasn't enough. I came away from it with a really renewed hope that we were going to come out with some positive solutions. But of course, nothing's happened since. I've been reaching out to them to say, hey, I wasn't interested in having a photo op. I actually want to help work on some solutions to end the violence. You know, are we going to continue this conversation? And that hasn't been reciprocated.
Okay.
So.
Was Lewis March part of that?
Yes.
Okay. So
yes.
I wanted to touch on this. So I'm familiar with Lewis March and the work he's doing. And I think he's a level-headed guy. I think he's got a good understanding of what mm-hmm. needs to happen. My challenge is when I saw the Senate hearing and he was on there proposing his support for C-71, mm-hmm. the challenge I had with that was the fact that he recognizes that this is not the answer.
Yeah.
But yet says, I still want to move forward with this because if at all it stops even a percentage, a tiny little percentage,
right.
that's going to be better than nothing. Is that what we're looking for with C-71?
I tweeted, actually, I think he even said it would not be a real, C-71 would not be a real solution to crime, but it would be symbolic. It blows my mind that people are willing to, you know, impose further restrictions on millions of good Canadians who are doing nothing wrong as a symbol. I'm sick of symbols. I'm sick of photo ops. I'm sick of empty promises. I'm sick of everybody virtue signaling.
Mm-hmm.
You know, either we want to do some credible work towards ending violence and crime in our streets, or we don't. And that's where we're at. So, yeah, I found it very disappointing. There was a number of witnesses that day who testified who say one thing behind closed doors and another thing entirely on social media. It's disappointing, but this is the battle we're in.
And if C-71 isn't the answer, right, then mm-hmm. why not scrap it and let's try to come together and create the answer? We want the same things.
Well, that's right. And here's the other thing, too. There's going to be some considerable resources soaked up by C-71. There's going to be additional requirements placed on the CFOs of every single province. There's no additional funding coming from the federal level to go to the CFOs to accommodate all these additional requirements that are a result of C-71. So you've got, you know, CFO's offices who are behind on background checks on people and license applications and renewals, and, you know, they're already in chaos there. And now we're lumping all this extra work on them with no resources as a symbol of doing absolutely nothing.
And taxing a system that is already overextended and
yeah.
therefore can't effectively do their
That's
job,
right.
causing more problems.
Right. You've got some people who have been through some really traumatic experiences, and I think they're yearning to just want anything to grasp onto to say something's changed. They're willing to accept that.
You know, we really commend you for the hard work that you're doing. Thank you sincerely for
Thanks,
that.
Thanks, Corey.
And I really want everybody to know, support what Tracy's doing at the CCFR. Go out there, get a membership, donate, purchase some clothing, whatever you can do so that you can enjoy your firearms activities and not have to deal with the fight that these people are doing. What does it cost for
$40 a year for an individual membership, which comes with $5 million of personal liability insurance. My car, I pay $100 a month to insure my car. Oh. I've never had an accident. Firearms are so safe, we can insure you for an entire year included in that $40. So
one box of 20 match grade ammunition is like $60.
Right.
I'm sure that you guys can put it aside and do that. Please do help support the fight, because pretty soon it's not even going to be an option. we're not going to have anything left to grasp onto.
And so you don't miss out. Like us on Facebook, follow us on Instagram, and subscribe to us on YouTube.com. This is Coat of Arms.